For this video, we're going to go through and show you guys how to do a brake inspection. We're not going to be doing any repairs in this video, but more so of showing you guys what to look for on your cars at home, just to make certain your brake system is up to snuff. We're going to start our brake inspection in the rear in this case. With the hubcap off, you should see the axle nut, which should have a cotter pin in place, which needs to be removed. Once it is removed, we can loosen the rear axle nut. The axle nut should be extremely tight and is normally going to require the use of a breaker bar and typically a section of pipe for additional leverage. The rear axle nuts on all VWs are standard threaded on both sides. After the axle nut is loose, we loosen the lug bolts and then we can jack up the rear of the car. Make sure to support the rear of the car with jack stands and then we can remove the rear wheel. With the parking brake off, remove the brake drum. If the drum does not come off with some heavy pulling, you may have to go on the back side of the brake and loosen the brake adjusters to pull some of the tension off to allow it to come off. Oftentimes, tapping on the drum with a hammer may help it slide off as well. With the drum off, we can now inspect the brake surface inside the drum. Here we see a deep groove that has been worn into the surface. This isn't a big deal because as long as the brake was within specs, it can be turned by your local brake or auto shop. If the drum is out of spec, meaning it's been turned too many times before, or is excessively warped, the brake drum will need to be replaced. Looking at the backing plate, we now inspect the brake shoes. On the left side, the brake shoes are in good shape, the pads have good thickness, and are evenly worn. There aren't any signs of moisture or any other damage to the brake shoe. However, on the right side, we notice the brake shoes are cracked excessively. Along with being cracked, the right side brake shoes are wearing unevenly as well. The front shoe is narrower than the rear shoe, so these brake shoes will have to be replaced. The wheel cylinder boots are in good shape and are not leaking. The brake shoe retaining pins, springs, and caps are all intact. The parking brake push bar is properly installed between the shoes and the lever. The parking brake cable is attached to the pull lever properly. We see that the upper brake shoe tension spring is in place and held to the push bar with the retaining clip, and that the lower brake shoe tension spring is in place as well. The brake shoe adjuster screws and nuts are all in good shape, and the tension tab is intact on both sides. Lastly, on the rear, we'll take a look at the brake hydraulics. Behind the backing plate, inspect the steel brake lines. Look for any crimps, kinks, cracks, or leaking. Also look at the brake hoses. Look for any bubbles, and again, cracks, kinks, or leaks. Make sure that the brake bleeder valves on the wheel cylinders are intact. With the rear inspection complete, it's time to take a look at the front brakes. As we did with the rear, we're going to loosen the lug bolts before we jack up the front of the car. With the front of the car jacked up, we support it on jack stands and remove the front wheels. On the left side, the speedometer cable clip will have to be removed from the speedometer cable so that we can pop off the grease caps with a pry bar or, in our case, a pickle fork. Now we can loosen the axle nut screw with a 6mm Allen wrench and we can remove the axle nut. The left-hand side nut is reversed or left-hand threaded, so it will turn to the right to remove it. The right side axle nut has a standard thread. Now we can pull the brake drum off. If the drum doesn't come off, again, as we mentioned, you may have to go through and loosen the brake adjuster screws to release some tension to allow it to come off easily. When you pull off the brake drum, the thrust washer and inner bearing will come out with the drum. Now is a good time to inspect the bearings, both the inner and outer, and the seals, looking for any grooves, wear marks, a lack of grease, and to make certain that the inner wheel seal is not cracked up, dried, or missing. With the brake drum off, we inspect the brake surface inside the drum, looking for any cracks, or as we see here, a deep groove that has been worn into the surface. Again, same as on the rear, as long as the drum is within specs, it can be turned by a local automotive shop. If the drum is out of spec, it needs to be replaced. We'll take a look at the brake shoes now. And on the left side, the brake shoes are in good shape. The pads have good thickness, are evenly worn, and there isn't any sign of moisture or any other damage. However, on the right side, the brake shoes are unevenly worn. The top shoe is thicker than the bottom shoe here. The wheel cylinder boots are in good shape, and they are not leaking. The brake shoe retaining pins, caps, and caps are all in place. On the left-hand side, we can see that the front and rear brake shoe tension springs are both in place properly. On the right side, we see the rear tension brake spring is in the wrong location on the bottom. The spring is rubbing against the wheel cylinder boot, which isn't torn fortunately, and this is most likely the reason that these shoes are wearing unevenly. Otherwise, the brake shoe adjuster screws and nuts are in good shape, and the tension tabs are intact. We'll take a look on the back side of the backing plate at the brake hoses, looking for any bubbles, cracks, kinks, or leaking. On the left-hand side, the brake hose is in good shape, but unfortunately the right side brake hose was installed incorrectly. This caused the hose to kink and crack, so it needs to be replaced. It is also unlikely with this hose that this brake was actually working properly. We'll also take a look at the steel brake lines, looking for any kinks, cracks, or leaks as well. on both wheel cylinders, make sure that the brake breather valves are intact, which they are on the left-hand side, but unfortunately on the right-hand side, the brake breather valve is broken off, so this wheel cylinder will have to be replaced. With the front left wheel off, we can see the master cylinder, and we're going to look for leaks, which would be apparent with any moisture on the frame head below. We'll also take a look at the feed lines from the reservoir up above, looking for any cracks, leaks, or otherwise. The brake light switches and wiring should be in place, and there shouldn't be any leaking or moisture apparent. Lastly, we'll check all the brake lines going from the master cylinder, making certain that all the steel lines are not cracked, kinked, or leaking as well. With the hood open in the trunk, we can take a look at the brake fluid reservoir, which in our case has a non-vented cap, so that will need to be replaced. With the cap removed, we can take a look at the fluid level and look for any dirty fluid or any debris in the fluid. Lastly, we'll take a look at the feed hoses from the reservoir to the steel lines, and again the steel lines on the top side for any leaks or cracks. With our brake inspection complete, we've noted that we only have issues on the right-hand side of the car, but we will replace the shoes, wheel cylinders, and hoses on both the left and right sides of the front, and we will replace the brake shoes on the left and right sides of the rear. The reason we do this is to keep the brake system equal from left to right side. That way, when you hit the brakes, the car doesn't pull too hard to one side or the other. This is important on brake drum systems, and especially old VWs. Old Volkswagens don't have automatic adjusting brake shoes like more modern cars do, so what you do to one side of the brake system, you do to the other.